U.S. Martish Radio is part of DesignNetwork.org, exclusive architecture and design podcasts reaching creative listeners worldwide.
Hi, this is Dale Kutsera, author of Paul Hayden Kirk and the Rise of Northwest Modern, and you're listening to U.S. Modernist Radio.
Welcome to U.S. Modernist Radio, where we talk and laugh with people who enjoy, own, create, dream about, preserve, love, and hate modernist architecture, the most exciting and controversial buildings in the world. Raleigh architect Aaron Sterling Lewis is our special co-host today, and we'll be talking to author Elizabeth A.T. Smith. Her famous book on the case study house is an architectural heavyweight champion. The New York Times said, "You need a California workout to lift it," but the book, an exhaustive homage to the houses, is worth the effort. Architecture critic J.P. Cohen said, "This book is a true gem, and considering its size, it's the Hope Diamond." And then there was everyone's favorite architect from Seinfeld, Art Vandelay, who said, "People don't even get an appointment unless they've read her book." Later on, we welcome a John Lautner homeowner who's been on Batman, the Monkees, and the ultimate 60s teen movie, Beach Blanket Bingo, musical guest Donna Lauren. And now, your host, Mr. Modernism, George Smart.
Thanks, Tom. Happy holidays, everyone.
Ah.
Oh, yeah. Our annual bells. And hi, Aaron. What's been happening with you the past year? Any interesting projects?
Yeah, some really great projects. Some really cool houses. I'm really lucky to be working with amazing people on amazing lots with amazing ideas. So it's great. It's been a lot of fun.
So anything specifically amazing you can talk about?
So the first house that I started in my office just a little over a year ago is under construction now out in the middle of nowhere, Hillsboro, North Carolina. And I'm really excited about that. It's going to be a very simple, it's really just a black box that looks at a meadow. Really simple.
Okay. Nice. Nice.
Yeah.
Now, did you study the case study houses in school?
Yeah. Yeah, we did.
How was it presented? Is it like old-timey stuff that's not relevant anymore, or is it like new, exciting? How do they teach it in architecture school?
Well, I just so happen to have a very vibrant history, architecture history teacher, Wallace Miller, who loved modernism, anything modern she loved. And so she brought a very special spirit to the class all the time, no matter what it was about. So that's what I got to learn it under. And so that was very exciting to me.
And you have a very modern bent in your design work.
True. I try. Yes.
If there was another case study house competition, I think you'd want to enter.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah.
I would love to.
And for the last 14 years, Aaron has been one of our most involved, most supportive fans. She's attended our events, rallied her clients, and contributed to our various projects. And it's no surprise that she's a fellow in the National AIA and also one of their Young Architects of the Year winners. Her clients love working with her, and she's a good sport, especially last year with our Festivus tribute. Did anyone ask you about that, Aaron?
Only my dad.
It's a dad thing, you know?
Definitely a dad thing.
And what did he say?
He was just wondering what the hell it was. And asking me how I know anything about that. I had no good answers.
So you want to do our sponsor spot?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
All right, here we go. In our ongoing story, modernist realtor Angela Rowell dated Harry Potter at 17 as she attended Le Corbusier High School,
home of the Fighting Piloti,
just down the road from Hogwarts. They never played each other in soccer, but their proms were legendary, particularly the year they did Stairway to Heaven. Although ridiculed by architecture students for dating a magician, she learned how to conjure up the slightly tipsy ghost of Mies and aced all the exams, becoming valedictorian. Now, she's one of the few real estate agents with formal architecture training, giving practical advice to buyers and sellers. Plus, she knows what wizards like to eat.
Handy.
Angela Rowell is our magic spell for modernist houses. Reach her at angelarowell.com, that's R-O-E-H-L, or 919-995-0550.
Wow. That's usually the point where George says, "Thank you, Tom," but I say, "Thank you, Aaron." You know, George, I'm sitting here thinking it's a holiday show. Some people might not know what the case study houses are.
make the show kind of a lump of coal in their stocking? You want to help us out?
Sure, because we don't want that. This show needs to be like getting an Xbox in your stocking. So the Case Study House program ran from 1945 to 1966 and created designs for about 36 prototype homes, mostly in L.A., that could be easily and cheaply constructed during the post-World War II building boom. Arts and Architecture magazine editor John Intenza, a champion of modernism and a Harwell Hamilton Harris homeowner,
that fast five times,
attracted modern architecture's greatest talents, like Richard Neutra, Charles and Ray Eames, Craig Elwood, Raphael Soriano, Ralph Rapson, Rodney Walker, Eero Saarinen, and others, and published them in his magazine. You can see most all the old issues of Arts and Architecture featuring the case study houses in the U.S. Modernist Library at usmodernist.org/library. And there's one person who knows more about these great houses than anyone else. In fact, hundreds of years from now, I predict archaeologists will determine that today's guest, Elizabeth A.T. Smith, was the major reason modernism burst back on the scene in the late 20th century. In 1989, as curator of the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles, she curated the Blueprints for Modern Living exhibition, The History and Legacy of Case Study Houses. In 2002, she wrote the aforementioned book on the case study houses, worth its weight on any appropriately braced coffee table. And earlier this year, she was awarded by the government of France the insignia of Chevalier of the Order of Arts and Letters for helping American audiences connect with French artists. That's a big honor few Americans get. She's now executive director of the Helen Frankenthaler Foundation, and her other books delve into Buckminster Fuller, techno-architecture, and sculpture by women. Welcome, Elizabeth.
Thank you. Thank you for that very nice introduction.
So before we get started, can I ask you, what's the AT stand for? Is it architecture today, perhaps?
That's a good one. Yes, I wish it were, but actually the A stands for Angel, which is my grandmother's name, and the T stands for Taft, which is a family name. So I guess if you're if you have a name like Elizabeth Smith, your parents try to do whatever they can to spice it up. Distinguish it a little bit more.
When you got this award from the French government, did you go to Paris or was it virtual?
Oh, unfortunately, it was still during COVID that I was given this award. So it was a hybrid event, in half in person at the French consulate in New York and half virtual with an online group of people participating. Unfortunately, couldn't be in Paris.
I imagine that being the French, they gave you a medal and not a trophy. Is that right?
They did give me a little medal. It's actually very elegant. I don't know where the heck I would ever wear it, but it's really nice to have, and it's a huge honor.
I would think you could just, you know, put it on, go out to the Kroger, go, hello.
Everyone would know.
Yes.
Or go to Maxim's you know, some French restaurant in Paris.
Right.
So, Elizabeth, you have been to France before. Tell us about your first trip to France at 12 with your grandfather.
Gosh, back then, my grandfather traveled to France every year on business. And the year after my grandmother died, because she always used to go with him, he took me along.
Hmm.
And it was really a wonderful thing for, you know, a kid at that age to be able to experience traveling to a foreign country, very exotic at that time. People didn't travel back then the way they do now with their kids. So, it was a pretty wonderful introduction.
Was that the trip that had you fall in love with France?
You know, I've made many trips to France over the years since then, and I think I've fallen in love with it in a different way every time. But that started me off down the path for sure.
How was it different going back as an adult?
Well, of course, as an adult, you know, I was often doing work-related things when I was there. And being in the business that I'm in, which is art and architecture, of course, work is always a pleasure. And I find myself doing things that, you know, I would do anyway. You know, I would always love to visit museums or to see, you know, architectural works and things like that. So I think that was the main difference, you know, that I had a real focus as an adult when I would go back to France that I didn't have as a kid.
Yeah, I can see sitting around the conference table at the staff meeting where you worked going like, okay, someone's going to go to France. Who's going to be? And you're raising your hand.
Yeah, right. So many wonderful things to see there. And I feel like I haven't even scratched the surface yet.
Well, Elizabeth, what really was the Case Study House program? How did it get started and why is it important?
Well, it really is Southern California's foremost contribution to, 20th century architecture. I think without question, we can look at the Case Study House program and say, you know, this group of houses, this initiative made a real difference. And it produced some of the really, top tier works of the 20th century. If you think of buildings like the Charles and Ray Eames House, like the Pierre Koenig design for Case Study House number 22, et cetera. Those are really iconic works of mid-century modern architecture, and those came out of the Case Study House program.
Was there one person in particular who pushed it along, or was it a group effort?
Oh, well, the guiding light, the guiding force behind the program was John Entenza, the editor of Arts and Architecture magazine. He was the real guiding light for the program. It was his idea. When he had taken over being the editor of Arts and Architecture in the 1940s, he really revamped the magazine to become an organ of modernism in every respect, not just architecture and design, but modern art, modern music, literature, progressive political views.
Wow.
Like the whole spectrum. But, first and foremost, he was interested in architecture and design. So he had a vision that after the end of World War II, there would be a need and an opportunity to put something new in front of the public. And his idea for the Case Study House program was to invite a number of architects who he felt were some of the most creative minds of their generation and ask them to design and build prototypical, low-cost, modern houses intended for typical American families, quote-unquote. So he had an initiative in mind, and he wrote about it in the pages of the magazine. And the idea was that when the houses were built, and even along the way, when they were first announced and their designs were developed, everything would be chronicled in the magazine. And then the houses would be, when built, opened up to the public who could tour them and actually get a look inside, one of these new houses. And, his vision was that then it would catch on like wildfire. And everybody would want to live in a modern house, and the builders, and the developers would all want to be creating modern houses, and the architects would have, a great deal of work, et cetera, et cetera.
That's amazing.
It didn't exactly turn out that way, but that right. was the initial goal. That was the impetus.
It's a great vision. How well was it received by the public?
Well, I think it was mixed. Certainly, there was a lot of interest in the houses, and apparently when the first ones that were fully constructed were opened up for touring, they received like 300 and some thousand visitors. So, that's a huge number of people. But, modern architecture wasn't for everybody. It still isn't for everybody, unfortunately, but we're trying to change that.
We are too,
Yeah. But, at that time in early 1940s, like the later 1940s after World War II, I don't think a lot of people had been exposed to modern architecture. And, some of them found it interesting, but others found it kind of strange. I mean, a lot of people had, traditional tastes. They wanted a house with a pitched roof. They didn't like a house with a flat roof, and they, didn't want to be exposed to the world with, walls of glass and that kind of thing. But there were certain other people that embraced it. And so, of course, it became a more and more accepted style, if you will, and method of approach to residential design, especially in the 50s. And into the 60s.
Did a lot of houses at low cost get built because of this?
Well, I mean, the houses themselves, especially the first ones, the ones that were built in the early years were, they were pretty low cost. I mean, they were small. Mm-hmm. And, they made use of simple industrial materials. And there was no, there was no desire to create some kind of a great statement. I mean, it was really about making functional yet very livable and habitable modern houses that would frame a kind of lifestyle that was seen as appropriate in the aftermath of World War II you know, thinking about young families with children, thinking about the warm climate in Southern California that, you know, allowed for so much indoor-outdoor living. That was all part of the case study house aesthetic. So it really did result in bringing about a number of, you know, small, very, very wonderfully designed, low-cost modern houses. And it did inspire others. There were many architects living and working in L.A. who were, you know, modernists, considered themselves modernists. Not all of them participated in the case study program. Only a handful did in that. But there were many other architects designing and building related houses. And while one of Intense's goals would have been to have the large housing developers, the builders, take on building tracts of case study houses, that didn't happen. But yet there were a few pockets, a few areas where multiple examples of case study houses were built. So it did have an impact. It definitely had a big impact in the area.
Elizabeth, why wasn't Frank Lloyd Wright part of this?
That's an interesting question. I mean, Frank Lloyd Wright was probably considered too established already and not somebody who would have been of the same generation as the other case study architects, most of whom were pretty young. I would say that Richard Neutra was the one participant in the program who was a bit older than the others. The rest of them were, you know, for the most part, early in their career. Frank Lloyd Wright had been around for a long time at that point. I think he was, you know, considered a little bit old hat, perhaps. But, of course, his works were, you know, inspiring to some of what the case study architects would later develop.
Now, what about Philip Johnson? He was a younger guy then.
Yeah, you know, Philip Johnson was more an East Coast person. And the case study houses were done primarily by Californian architects or people, you know, based on the West Coast. One of the exceptions was Ralph Rapson, because he was based in the Midwest.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Philip Johnson was a very East Coast person, and I don't know if he and Intensa had any real contact. I mean, I'm sure Intensa, you know, knew about him, knew of his work, but, you know, think about the fact that Philip Johnson was designing buildings in tandem, sort of in parallel with the trajectory of the case study houses. I mean, he was creating wonderful designs out east, but it was a very different climate, you know, different clientele, and it wasn't part of like a concerted program.
And he wasn't looking for something else to do.
Well, probably not, no, far from it. And I also think Johnson was a great individualist, and he might not have wanted to be part of a, you know, sort of a group effort like the case study house program. I'm just guessing, don't know for sure. It's great to speculate who else could have been part of it and also to think about why certain people weren't part of it who you might, you know, have thought would be. For instance, Rudolf Schindler, very important L.A. modern architect, was not invited to be part of the case study program. But a lot of his buildings were very, you know, germane to what the case study architects themselves later did.
Why wasn't he invited? Did people not like him?
You know, what we don't really know. What we do know is that Intensa invited people specifically to participate. So we don't really have insights into why he didn't bring certain people in.
He did die fairly young. He died in 53, I think.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But some have said that John Intensa had a particular penchant for architects who were interested in, you know, very industrial approaches to building, especially as the program went on. And so he tended to gravitate to people like Pierre Koenig or Craig Elwood, Rafael Soriano, and architects who used steel. You know, those were the folks that were really trying to bring about a change in building practices so that residential buildings would be built more with steel. And it was kind of a, you know, they were sort of machine aesthetic type of architects in the vein of some of the earlier European modernists. So Intensa might have preferred that approach because he may have felt it was more progressive, you know, that there was more of a sort of industrial and technological future in that way.
Interesting. Can you tell us about the 1989 exhibition? What started that and what was it like?
Oh, yeah. Well, that exhibition, which was called Blueprints for Modern Living, History and Legacy of the Case Study Houses, was the first big exhibition I worked on as a curator at the Museum of Contemporary Art LA. And it was really the first major architecture exhibition that was done there. It came about because the director of the museum, whose name was Richard Koshalik, had been trained as an architect himself. as a young man. And then he later went into the museum field, became a museum director, and he wanted L.A. MoCA to do a program in architecture. He was looking at predecessors like the Museum of Modern Art, for instance, or the Walker Art Center that, you know, did have architecture exhibition programs. So I was a young curator at the time. I had a little bit of background, not too much, in architectural history because I'd studied it in graduate school. And I was put onto the project. I was assigned to help develop an exhibition devoted to the case study houses. So I worked on it with a team, like a growing team of people, for about 5 years. And it took about that long, you know, to realize the show because, well, just the research alone. You know, I went around to visit any and all of the case study houses that were still standing. That wasn't easy to find all of them even.
How many are left?
Well, oh, that's such a hard question. I mean, right now I couldn't, you know, what I say to you might not be accurate because I'm basing my recollections on, you know, research from a number of years ago. But I would say there were a good, you know, oh, I don't know, 12 to 15 maybe.
Okay. And
still
there, were there really, were 36 actually built or were they just designed?
No. There were 36 designed, and I think only about 24 were built.
Okay. Well, that's
but
not,
some of them, yeah, bad. But some of them were later torn down. Others were changed beyond recognition. They were remodeled.
Yeah. Terrible remodels.
Oh, some of the remodels were just awful. But to be optimistic about this, like some of them have actually been restored, you know, beautifully by more recent owners that are very sympathetic to modernism, and they want to make sure their houses are just right, just as they were. So pulling this exhibition together was a phenomenal experience. We worked with a fantastic team of people. We had a great advisory committee, including people like Esther McCoy, the historian who wrote the original
book on
the
Case City
Houses.
Oh, sure, wrote the original book, yes.
Yeah, and the architectural historian Rainer Banham, who's a legendary historian and somebody who really knew the field very well. And we had a number of other people working with us. But I think what was radical about the exhibition is that we decided to do something a little different than the usual architecture show. You know, generally you go to see an architecture exhibition, you see drawings, you see photographs, maybe
few models.
Scale models.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's about it. It's not the most, it's not the most exciting thing, especially for a general public. But we worked with some designers who decided that we should make the exhibition experiential. So we recreated at full scale in the spaces of the museum there two of the original case study houses.
Wow. Which ones?
One of them,
which ones?
Oh, it was fantastic. One of them was the Pierre Koenig case study house number 22.
The Stahl House.
Wow.
The Stahl House. And the other one was Ralph Rapson's design for the Greenbelt House that had never been built. It had been designed in 1945, but never built. So we had these two structures within the museum, fully furnished to scale, that people could walk into. And in a way, it approximated what the original folks who toured the built case study houses back in the 40s and 50s must have experienced.
That's great.
That's cool.
It was exciting, and it made a real impact. We had a tremendous response to the exhibition, and I truly believe it was the way of presenting it that helped that a lot.
It's kind of like in New York when the Museum of Modern Art did their Houses in the Garden series in the 40s and 50s.
Yeah. Yes.
So what happened to the houses after the exhibition closed?
Well, I mean, they were really just stage sets, you know, and that was the beauty of being able to do an exhibition in a place like Los Angeles, you know, where you have the Hollywood community to draw upon.
Yeah, you have the crafts.
So for instance, the Pierre Koenig House was not built out of steel. The reconstruction wasn't built out of steel. It was built out of wood that was like painted to look like steel. So everything, you know, was just deconstructed, you know, after the exhibition was finished, and I hope much of it was recycled.
Yeah.
But it just served the purpose of being like a wonderful environment for people to be in the exhibition itself.
Sherry Stahl Grunwald told us how fun it was to walk through the house with her brother Bruce and see it there recreated.
Yeah, it must have been an amazing experience for them. I mean, it must have been very strange, you know, to see that. I mean, people were just, you know, really kind of impressed with the whole thing and with the ingenuity of our wonderful exhibition designers, who I need to mention by name because they're Craig Hodgetts and Ming Feng. who have a practice called Hodgetts and Fung in LA, and they continue to do great work. So a shout out to them for, you know, really being visionaries behind the Case Study Houses show of 1989.
Elizabeth, I have a question for you. You've written about techno-architecture. What is that?
Oh, well, that book was done quite a while ago, and the title was actually given to the book by the publisher.
Oh.
It wasn't actually what I would have, you know, called the book myself, but the assignment I was given was to write about several different current architects' work, and all of them seemed to have in common this idea of inspiration from technology in some way.
Okay.
In some cases more overtly than others. Some of them, you know, influenced by the Case Study Houses and some not. But I think the techno-architecture moniker was seen as a kind of catchy title. I did an exhibition on the work of Schindler, R.M. Schindler, in Los Angeles at the Museum of Contemporary Art a number of years after the Case Study Houses. And it was, you know, it was phenomenal to be able to delve deeply into Schindler's work. He was such an inventive person and, you know, not well known enough at the time.
Right. We had his great-grandson on the show as a guest.
Great.
And then his son's wife, who is still living, and it turned out she was also Groucho Marx's therapist. A little
really?
Bit of, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
Wow. That's terrific. Well, I mean, I think he's one of my all-time favorites. I just love the, you know, the sort of the sense of experimentation and eccentricity and, you know, all the qualities that his work projects, I think, are just tremendous.
There was one architect in particular who really used the Case Study Houses as a springboard to a fantastic career, and he wasn't even a registered architect. That was Craig Ellwood.
Oh, yes, that's right. That's right. Yeah, his are some of the most beautiful of the Case Study Houses, in my opinion. I think that's an opinion that others shared. He just had a very elegant sensibility. You know, and given the fact that he wasn't a registered architect, I mean, he certainly knew his stuff, you know, and he just had this, like, really elegant sense of how to, you know, how to put a building together and ways to achieve this almost, like, effortless sense of, you know, indoor-outdoor flow and a real, you know, sort of beauty and gracefulness in his use of proportion and materials. He's another one of my all-time favorites.
Mine, too. It's really incredible to look at his body of work and how he started up that office and just how he marketed himself across Los Angeles and Southern California. And these houses are just still highly prized today.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they're just tremendous. And some of the ones that he did, you know, I mean, he did three houses in the case study program, but he did many others as well. And some of those are just exquisite. I've always wanted to do like a proper tour to, you know, as many Craig Ellwood houses as possible to see what they're like today.
Famed architectural photographer Julia Shulman took many of the photos for the Art and Architecture series, for the magazine, for the Case Study Houses. And he was still around when you did your book, right?
That's right. Yes, he was. He was a valued resource for sure. And he helped us, you know, certainly by providing photos for use in the book and also in the exhibition. We had a number of, like, large-scale, like, sort of photo blow-ups, some of his images. He deserves credit for helping to put the case studies on the map, surely. I mean, his images became so well-known, and some of them are just iconic. You know, people will instantly recognize some of those Julia Shulman images.
Los Angeles really led the way in inspiring not only many individuals, but just legions of architects for the next 50 years.
That's right.
Including some right in this very room.
Absolutely.
Right now.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I think it continues to be like a real hotbed for architectural innovation, and there's just so much great work to see there from over the decades. I mean, it's always interesting to see new work that's being done out there. And it's inspiring to visit, like, the older, more historical examples.
I've read about attempts at doing the Case Study House project again, making a new era of these houses and publishing them somewhere that people have thought about doing, but I've never actually seen it happen. Are you aware of any revivals of this kind of project?
Well, I'm actually not aware of any revivals that have succeeded to any large extent. I'm aware of, you know, sort of one-offs.
Right.
But as far as a kind of like a larger scale effort with a kind of impact that Intense envisioned, no.
Okay.
I'm not aware of that. And I don't know if it would be possible, you know, in this day and age. I mean, what do you all think? Do you think that this, that would be a viable...
Well, you know, sort of if thing? Kanye West can revitalize interest in modern architecture, then, anything's possible.
Then maybe you can, yeah. George. This is your
right.
opening.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
I mean, you can think about something like the tiny house movement.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You know, I mean, maybe that's so, an extension of a case study house idea in some kind of way, but it's certainly not the same thing. But, you know, I think the impulse toward, you know, a kind of like good design that's habitable, but, you know, in a way that's modest, I think that, you know, that shares certain affinities with the case study house program, or at least the goals, some of the goals behind it.
Yeah, I tell people all the time that if it's just two people living in a house, that you don't need as many square feet as you might think.
Right.
And that you can put all that money, and if you've really got a lot of money to burn, you can put a lot of that into like a house at the beach or a house in the mountains. So you can have two perfectly exquisite jewel box houses for you
Small houses. The
price of one that would normally be created.
That's very sound advice.
Case Study Houses is a must-have book for any modernist architecture fan, and it's available wherever fine books are sold. Thanks so much for joining us, Elizabeth.
It's my pleasure. Thank you for inviting me to speak with you today.
Singer and actress Donna Lauren's career began at age 5. She had her first commercial at 8 and her first record, I think it's Almost Christmas Time, at 9. Donna has been on nearly every classic 60s TV show you can think of. Batman, The Monkees, Hollywood Squares, American Bandstand, Shindig, The Milton Berle Show, The Merv Griffin Show, The Danny Thomas Show, The Mickey Mouse Club, The Dating Game, Gomer Pyle, and Dr. Kildare. In a career spanning 6 decades, she's shared the stage and screen with Adam West, Burt Ward, Zsa Zsa Gabor, Richard Chamberlain, Don Rickles, Paul Lynde, Linda Evans, Wally Cox, Jim Nabors, and even Buster Keaton. That goes back a ways. She went on to be the first and only Dr. Pepper girl in commercials and then had roles in films including Bikini Beach, Muscle Beach Party, Pajama Party, Sergeant Deadhead at Beach Blanket Bingo. Later on, Donna designed her own clothing line and opened 3 boutiques in Hawaii. She is the author of Pop 60s, Shindig, Dick Clark, Beach Party, and Photographs from the Donna Lauren Archive. And she's the host of the podcast Love's a Secret Weapon. And if that's not wonderful enough, kids, she used to own a John Lautner house.
Wow.
Welcome, Donna.
Thank you, George. It's a pleasure being with you.
So, Donna, before we talk about architecture or movies, like the plot of a teenage film, you married your 1960s prom date, Jared, in 1995. What was that love story all about?
I certainly did love. Yes, well, Jared and I were introduced by family members, and he escorted me as my prom date. And actually, both of us, many years later, when we became a romantic couple, we both kept our prom picture, and it served as our wedding invitation.
Oh, that's great.
That's nice. How did you reconnect after all that time?
Well, our lives were woven in and out of one another's, and it seemed to be in 1995 that both of us found ourselves single, and I was invited to Sedona to sing my song about Sedona that I wrote, and he was living there. And suddenly the bells and banjos just went off and we realized that we weren't just good friends and, you know, really found each other very trustworthy and felt safe with each other, but we actually felt the spark and so we became a couple.
Well, that's a great love story.
Thank you.
It might be one that might occur on the beach of one of these many beach films that you made.
Oh, and then, of course, we moved to Hawaii and spent 15 years there, so we were on the beach.
Yeah.
What was America's fascination with the bikini at that time? There were so many bikini films. I even found one just now that you were not in, surprisingly enough, called Dr. Goldfoot and the Bikini Machine with Vincent Price. I mean, what was all this fascination about? Was it just because they were new?
You know, we were in a revolutionary time in the 60s, and we went from the kind of proper puritanical Betty Crocker style, you know, into more of a women's liberation modality. Although, in my Dr. Pepper contract, I was not allowed to show my navel.
Oh, so, the navel clause, yes.
So that's why I was kind of an anomaly in films.
I think Barbara Eden had that same kind of thing in I Dream of Jeannie, right? Okay. She couldn't show her navel.
And Annette has a clause from Disney, but she kind of found a way around that by wearing a one piece that had mesh in the middle and it dipped below her waist. So it was kind of a peekaboo. You know?
So not only not in a Dr. Pepper ad, but in any show or movie, you couldn't show your navel?
Exactly.
Wow. So how long did that last?
Until I stepped away, I retired 2 years before my contract expired.
Because you retired in 68, I think?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
At the ripe old age of?
21.
Yeah.
Everybody you know, should
well,
do
I,
that.
I started it when I was five, so, you know, in dog years. You know,
it was a pretty
time.
Long run, Tom.
Right, that's true.
You know, AARP sends you that card right at 21 and says, you know, you got to be thinking about this stuff. Now, I found you originally, not through your films, but because in 2014, you and your husband bought the Marco Wolf Mountain Cabin, which was remodeled by John Lautner in 68. What kind of shape was it in when you bought it?
Oh, gosh. We lived there for 7 years, and we did some rejuvenation to the building and kind of removed unnecessary things that were added over the course of the years. It was in excellent condition because of the materials that Lautner chose. But what we realized is that on the property, it was an 11-acre property that overlooked the Palm Springs area and the whole Coachella Valley. It was a little cabin originally that I guess Marco Wolf bought, but when he bought it, he took the whole thing down and left a little bit of a foundation from the original cabin. So it is essentially a Lautner. It was called a remodel, I guess. I don't know why, but that's what their relationship was after Lautner, as you probably know, built his house in the Hollywood Hills before he built the cabin as a retreat.
And Lautner did some other projects for Wolf, too, I think.
Ooh, well, enlighten me.
I think there is a actual Wolf house in L.A.
Yeah, in the Hollywood Hills. It's kind of known as the Falling Waters in Lautner's, you know, world, because it was built on kind of a ledge, and it's still an 1,800-square-foot house with only one bedroom, but it's many levels with an infinity pool. And pretty much the same materials that he used there, he used for the cabin. He used hemlock for the exterior, and he used, it's a silver stone, I've forgotten the name of it. And, oh, he used corrugated walls. And living where we lived, the house was placed absolutely beautifully for views and for airflow and sunlight. There was a ridge of mountain that we estimate 99 miles from L.A., you know, like that Johnny Mathis song, which I just love.
Yeah.
And the ocean air, believe it or not, would fly in and the clouds would sit right where that house is. And the corrugated walls were built in the back. And they broke the wind. Sometimes the wind was just crazy because we were up at 4,000 feet elevation in the desert.
So the walls were a good thing.
The walls were excellent, and they were 15 inches thick.
Oh, holy cow.
Wow.
How did you get into the teen beach films? How did that come about for you?
Okay, going back to Dr. Pepper, I discovered that the president of the advertising agency that was out of Chicago was also a screenplay writer, and he co-wrote Muscle Beach Party and co-produced it. He had a plan to expand the companies to coast to coast. It was, when I started, it was a regional soft drink, and their idea was to expand into the teenage audience and go coast to coast. So that's how I was pretty much product placement in the first film. Yeah. And then the music director heard the commercials and found out that I could sing. And so he matched me up with Dick Dale and we did a duet.
This first song comes from Donna's biggest hit movie, the standard against which all teen films are inevitably compared, Beach Blanket Bingo, starring Frankie Avalon and Annette Funicello. Here's Donna with It Only Hurts When I Cry.
You ask me if I ever long for him, since we said goodbye. Sure, I get sad, but it's not too bad. It only hurts when I cry. You see, I hardly even think of him. His time goes slowly by. I just go on like there's nothing wrong. It only hurts when I cry. I remember our first kiss, the way I loved him then. Sometimes I think a love like this will never happen again. Oh, please don't ask me if I sigh for him. You know that I'll get by. I'll just pretend it's not the end. It only hurts when I cry. 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 I remember our first kiss, the way I loved him. Sometimes I think a love like this will never happen again. Please don't ask me if I sigh for him. You know that I'll get by. I'll just pretend it's not the end. It only hurts when I cry. 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 It only hurts when I cry.
That was beautiful.
Oh, thank you. You're bringing back memories.
You know, as I get older, I could do a new version of this called It Only Hurts When I Move.
I suggest Arnica.
Now, you were at a particularly important place on November 22nd, 1963. Tell us about that.
Well, it was a national bottlers meeting in Dallas, Texas. And I was to be introduced as the Dr. Pepper girl to launch this campaign. So 2,000 of the national bottlers that own franchises in the bottling plants. So I was in Dallas getting ready So around 1 o'clock, I was putting my clothes on and watching the television, and I see the motorcade of President Kennedy and Jacqueline going by the very hotel I was staying in. And as they turned the corner, the shots came. So being 16 years of age, I was totally devastated. Couldn't believe what I was seeing. Well, the phone rang, and it was the CEO of Dr. Pepper, Mr. Parker, who told me that no one is indispensable, dear. And I took it as, you know, the president isn't indispensable. I'm not indispensable. So in my youth, the primary reason my career began is because my parents were in a position to say to me at, you know, literally 7 years of age, we had a business meeting, and they told me that they thought I could make more money than them, and that was true. That's what it ended up being, is supporting a family of five. So when that call came from the CEO, my sense of responsibility toward my family was intermingled with the tragedy. So I did get myself together, and I did enter into that ballroom and saw 2,000 adults who were still waiting to see who was going to represent their company. And they put their president kind of on the back burner. And to me, it's shocking to this day.
Well, you know, there's a lot of weird things about that. They're still trying to figure out what happened on that fateful day.
But we know what happened to you.
Yeah.
You stood up and did your job. You're the family breadwinner, it sounds like.
Donna, tell us about your Love's a Secret Weapon podcast.
Oh, thank you for asking. And I do believe love is a secret weapon. You know, I know we're in transition. You know, it feels to me that creative souls on this planet are loving beings, and those that are trapped in arrogance and greed are really not the future that I see for this world. So a song that I sang, it was called Love's a Secret Weapon. I think it was Bikini Beach. And I decided to call a podcast when the pandemic started, Love's a Secret Weapon. And for about 5 years, I'd been working with a collaborator in Australia to write my autobiography. I just needed to put things down on paper, you know, how that feels when life seems intangible. So it took about 5 years, and I have a manuscript. So I thought, well, rather than going out and pursuing a publisher, I'm going to read my story. And while I was starting that process, I started asking guests on and people that were from my past. And I've had 2 seasons now, over 30 episodes. And now I'm at the third stage of inviting fans to be part of my podcast. And one that kind of surprised me is a television agent from William Morris. And he just turns out to be the most delightful person. His name is John Hartman. He ended up managing Joni Mitchell, Neil Young, and the Eagles. And
wow.
He just had this stellar career, and he's sharing it with me. It's going to be an amazing journey that he's going to take us on.
We're going to close out this Christmas show with a Christmas song. So here's Donna with Merry Christmas, Baby.
Give me a diamond ring for Christmas. I'm
song really holds up, Donna.
Yeah.
Oh, that was so fun.
And what do they say in Hawaii? Meli Kelikamaka or Kelimaka?
You got it.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's pretty close, Tom.
And aloha to you.
No, thank you.
Now, Don, I was hoping to get to visit with you at Modernism Week, but you're now in Arizona.
Yes, George. You know, though, I made a reservation. I'm going to be coming to Palm Springs at the very end of Modernism coming up in February.
Oh, great. Well,
so we will look forward to meeting with you.
We take over a whole hotel.
I understand.
You can come hang out with us if you want and visit. And
cool.
We'll do something by the pool.
I look forward to seeing you, George.
All right.
Thank you for being so kind and considerate.
Oh, well, thank you too, Donna, and we'll talk soon.
And Merry Christmas.
I love you.
Okay.
God bless you both.
Thanks to today's holiday co-host, architect Aaron Sterling Lewis, and thank everyone out there for listening all year long. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by Wendy Robineau and Don Beskin, and by Modernist Realtor Angela Roll. Okay, Tom, take us to the Christmas tree.
Visit usmodernist.org's massive archives to listen to past shows, discover documentation of 10,000 significant modernist houses, and access 4 million pages of classic 20th century architecture magazines. U.S. Modernist Radio is produced by Soundtracks Recording Studios in Raleigh, North Carolina. Our theme song was performed by George Smart and Robinson Earl. It was so good we didn't even play it this time. Rogue archivist Carrie Cesarino was not available for this show, so big thanks to Cindy Stratton,
not her real name,
who came out of retirement and stepped up today. U.S. Modernist Radio is a production of Modernist Archive Incorporated, a nonprofit educational archive for the documentation, preservation, and promotion of modernist residential design. I'm Tom Guile. George and I'll be back soon with another Deck the Halls with Florida Ceiling Windows edition of U.S. Modernist Radio.
La 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 la.
Thank you.